And welcome back, everybody, to Game 2 of 5NQ versus Don't Die, who, as I'm looking over here, I had a pause. I was like, their name was Don't Die, right? Apparently changed their team name. So, apparently they can do that at a LAN event. Hey, no problem. No problem. But a Game 2 of Don't Die versus 5NQ, it was a pretty close game. 5NQ actually had some really amazing plays, especially QO with that Aegis steal in game one. Pretty much secured the victory for them. It looked like Don't Die were going to have a little bit of a turnaround, but unfortunately they just weren't able to seal the deal as the Aegis was stolen away from them. And now we're going to get into game two, and hopefully Don't Die are going to be able to turn it around a little bit as we get into the draft. And I welcome my co-caster, Clairvoyance Man. What'd you think? What'd you think? Of your first Korean game
you know,
watching.
Cap, quite possibly, I'm amused and enlightened. Mm-hmm. This has possibly been some of the best Dota I've seen in 2014. And what can I say? I'm just absolutely flabbergasted by the plays coming out of my potential brothers, my blood brothers back in the homeland. Very, very respectful of those individuals and working hard. But, you know, of course, because I am a full-blown American now, I got to respect and represent America.
Oh, well,
that's how we do in America.
Of course.
But, you know, I kind of felt, as I was watching the screen while you were in the intro, I was wondering to myself as well, man, like, Koreans in general, they are very, very stringent when it comes to professional appeal and entertainment business. Because, I mean, me being a Korean myself, like, I understand how they portray things in society and stuff like that. So I'm actually genuinely surprised, too, that they would let something like this pass. Because if this is significant in the Western scene, this has got to be of some sort of significance in Korea specifically. Like, High Five DDR, Don't Die Remix to High Five of Teenagers. I'm not sure if that kind of changes. I'm actually pretty surprised as a whole that Koreans would actually overlook something like that.
I
have a funny story, actually, if you don't mind me just sharing.
Go for it.
You know, Pretty Boy Swag, I do believe that they are going to Korea as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure if you know about that, but basically, there's a player named Jubei on the team. And Jubei is actually a reference to a Japanese swordsman back in the day, a samurai, if you would. Mm-hmm. And they forced him to change his name because of the, I guess, the Japanese-Korean relations and how they don't really want to bring up the Japanese history up to the Korean audience. Yeah, it's that stringent, man.
What?
They care about this stuff, bro. So I'm surprised that they can just change their name from Don't Die Remix to High Five of Teenagers, man. That's a darn surprise to me in 2014 America. You know what I'm saying?
Oh my goodness. 10 seconds remaining. I can't believe you just told me that. That's hilarious. 5 seconds.
Dude,
right.
The things you see in 2014, capitalist, man. Yeah. What can I tell you? See, I guess you can see reverse picks, for example. 5NQ deciding to opt the opponent's strategy this time and saying, we're going to pick the Slark, we're going to pick the Visage, and we're going to show you how to play it. And, and this is kind of the mentality that's coming up by them. They're gearing up for the bans.
Yeah, it's like the ultimate shutdown. It's just like, hey, why don't we go ahead and run your draft for you?
Yeah,
and show you
much.
How to really play the game. How about that? Well,
let me tell you, Cap, man, the animosity between Koreans, the internal disrespect, the clashing of egos, there is no country in the world that does it better than we do, man. We are, like, the reason why we're the esports hub is because, man, these guys, bunch of scrawny guys like myself with big heads. That's what we are, man. We're headstrong. We're not body strong. But we'll body you head to head. That's just how it works. And you know, High Five of Teenagers, they don't have none of that. They say, we're going to ban the Queen of Pain because I get the feeling you're going to try to use it against us. And 5NQ just says, fine, you banned the Priestess instead last game, so we'll take it this game. And High Five of Teenagers decides to opt for the Luna, working for a similar strategy of what the opposition is thinking, saying, you're going to take our draft, we're going to take yours also. High Five.
Yeah, just getting into their heads, really. So we saw Alchemist, Timbersaw, Storm Spirit, Queen of Pain all banned out by High Five of Teenagers. I still can't get over the name change, but whatever. Venomancer, Lifestealer, OD, and Viper banned out by 5NQ. Clockwork, Rubik, Luna, now waiting on that fourth pick, picked up by Don't Die, which is going to be the Shatter Demon, so that is your second support. Slark, Visage, Mirana, and now waiting on the fourth pick for 5NQO. And I got to say, I already kind of like it. I mean, really, it's just me really favoring Luna as a carry in this meta right now. It's just that's really what it comes down to. But every single time I see Luna in a draft, I'm like, it just leans me immediately towards that draft. But they've got a very, very defensive supports around it, so a very, very 4-protect-1 strategy that we might be seeing. Clockwork as a nice little initiator to be able to create a lot of room for Lunar to be able to work around. But 5 and Q, a lot of aggression coming out with the Slark, the Mirana. Those are heroes that, again, they may be snowball-oriented, but they are not very dependent. They aren't really great going into late game. And if they go into late game, you're talking 45, 55 minutes in, you better have one hell of a gold lead on those heroes if you want to go that late. So 5 and Q looking to possibly end this game early. While High 5 trying to protect their Luna and push it as late as possible.
Yep. And you know what, Cap? I would actually share your sentiments in the exact lining if I didn't see that Shadow Demon as the fourth pick. Because quite frankly, I understand how well Luna synergizes with the Shadow Demon as a support. And I understand how powerful Rubick is with the Clockwork. But, you know, as much as Luna is one of those heroes like Warlock, except the carry version, where it's like if you just toss it into a random lineup of four heroes and make it five, that one specific hero will actually make your lineup look good. Like Luna will make any lineup look good, just like how a Warlock in any composition would make the lineup look good or viable somehow, because those heroes are there. But when you pick two defensive supports like the Rubick as well as Shadow Demon, position dependent, initiation dependent, and have these factors that kind of get dictated by how they play in the team fight. Like they're very, very dependent on how they cast their spells and which targets, because Shadow Demon just is a hero. Oh, I should just say champion just to troll you, but...
you almost said champion there, didn't you?
Shadow Demon is actually a hero that has a lot of room for mistakes. With that first spell, with that disruption, if you get that on the wrong target in the middle of the teamfight, that could spell death and disaster for some of the most critical targets inside the middle of the teamfight. And Templar Assassin. Templar, Luna, Clockwork, Shadow Demon, a very common four composition. You might even take out the Shadow Demon and just say, put the Rubick in there and then plus one at the end. We've seen these kind of lineups before. They're no surprises. And as I say, that Darkseer gets picked up. So, wow, a blast into the past it is. But, you know, I got to be a little bit skeptical, because HLT's lineup, once again, very powerful in individual heroes. But as for the game plan, you know, I see they want to progress. And as you said, they want to hold on to their towers and they might transition, because 5 and Q doesn't have the best of the best late game available to them against the Luna. But at the same time, with those support heroes, they're looking to get stuff done. And I'm not sure what kind of commitments they're going to make, but they better gear their game mentality towards one specific goal, because as soon as that objective aim goes away, things are going to start to fall apart with those heroes.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, man. Going to need a large amount of farm. Let's go ahead and look at what exactly, who's playing what. 5 and Q, we got a QO going to be playing that Slark. Sangin's going to be on the Mirana this time, Anarchy on that Visage. Cynical on the Darkseer, and FX is going to be rounded off on the Crystal Maiden once again. Meanwhile, on HOT, we're going to keep calling him Don't Die, because that's just whatever. The Park is on Shadow Demon, Karn on Luna, Depot on Templar Assassin, J-God on the Rubick, and Remix is going to be on the Clockwork.
Come on, Cap. They're hot. Can't you respect that, man?
I guess so. Hot.
Hot, man.
That's what they need. They're like, all right, game two, what's our strategy, guys? Do we go for a certain draft that we have in our pocket? Do we go ahead and ban all the heroes that really effective last game? No, we go ahead and change our team name. That's what we do.
How about they just get hot? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If they're hot, they're good, man. Although they still got the DDR banners flagging all around their base.
See, this would make more sense if they went ahead and won game one. Now we're hot, you know, we're going to keep this hot streak going, right? No.
The fire going, man. Yeah, unfortunately, that's the case. And I see now why the sudden surge of Darkseer has occurred. Yep. It's the Templar Assassin counter, the old-fashioned, old-school. I wonder how this is going to go. It's been a very long time. Darkseer used to win this matchup, and Templar Assassin could stay even if they were experienced. But there have been a slight number of changes to both heroes, mainly the Darkseer, but more importantly, a lot of metagame changes. So Darkseer already looking to be extremely, extremely aggressive, trying to abuse that Iron Shell, but he should be aware that the Iron Shell in the early levels does not actually burn the refraction, so he will have to be somewhat careful.
Yeah, he hits a diving past tier 1 tower, can't be that far out, but he is going to be trying to spam that out as much as possible and pick up that nice early bottle. Meanwhile, the aggressive tri-lane going up against, and you can already see Karn dropping pretty low here, and it's no surprise, Crystal Maiden, Visage, that duo is very, very powerful in lane. You add in a good nuker like a Mirana, being able to add in that extra arrow and Star Storm. These heroes have to be, really the supports have to be on top of this game. And Shadow Demon has to hit some really good disruptions here in order to dodge either that heavy nuke of Visage or the Mirana looking for that arrow. That's probably going to be the most important one. But these supports are really going to have to be on top of their game. And even then, even if they don't get caught out, just the harassment of these three ranged heroes going up against the Luna, with that short range, she's going to have a real hard time picking up a lot of the CS. So this is going to be a bit of a hard lane. Meanwhile, bottom, we got the Clockwork going up against the Slark. This matchup, I mean, any matchup, Slark melee versus melee, you know, I'm going to give advantage to him. But Clockwork also really, really strong early on and has that high level of battery assault to really force Slark out. So even with the stat, Essence Shift, Steel, it's still, Remix could very easily, and as you can see, traps him in the cogs, and QO gonna try and fight as much as possible. Unfortunately, the battery salt is really just not hitting QO. And now the leap. He's gonna go in for that kill and snags it with a big auto attack and picks up that first blood. So nicely done by him, and it really just came down to the battery assault, unfortunately, just hitting a lot of those creeps barely outside of the cogs and mitigate a lot of that damage, allowing Slark to go deep. Meanwhile, Arrow going out. J-God getting very, very low. Auto attack. Sagan able to snag it. Anarchy also might just pay the price. Karn going to try and go for that auto attack, and unfortunately, he goes down, and 5 and Q keep all three heroes up alive in this aggressive tri-lane and pick off two on hot. So their defensive tri-lane, again, we foresaw some pretty poor laning phase going to go down for them. And that's exactly what happens.
Yeah, Cap, honestly, I'd be so surprised if 5 and Q lose any of their lanes in this state right now. I mean, even if the Darkseer and the Templar go even and Templar somehow finds a good way to get things going, the first blood kill by the Slark meant so much, because then he would not only have sustainable region, but we see the impact now. 3 minutes into the game, the Slark has treads already, so the Clockwork can no longer exchange efficiently at all against the Slark, even if you factor in the battery assault. Slark's attack speed is so fast that he'll just attack between them and just steal stats.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's the end of that story. Whereas at the top lane, once again, two defensive supports, you lose your lane with those kind of supports, and of course, the only way they would have actually won is in a 3v1 scenario. If you lose your lane with these kind of supports, these supports don't transition into the mid-late game very well. Rubick, maybe, depending on the spells that he can steal and how well he plays, but aside from that, once again, Shadow Demon just has so much room for mistakes, efforts, and post-nerfs. You know, he has limitations on his vision giving and all the other bonuses that a support hero could bring aside from the laning phase. So I really am very fearful of HOT already 4 minutes into the game, and by the first nighttime, just as I say nighttime, you know, hope is becoming dimmer for their lanes right now, and I'm not sure how they're going to transition with these kind of heroes.
Yeah,
I'm very scared for them.
Me neither, man. I mean, they're going to have a really hard time in that 15 to 25 minute mark. You can already see how 5 and Q are just going to be so far ahead in farm that they could very easily turn this into a stomp, pretty much, where they're able to pick off heroes consistently. And now with the double damage picked up by Cynical, Depot's having an even harder time. Meanwhile, top Karn going to get gone on here. Arrow, unfortunately, not able to do its work. And Sagan, after the leap, gets hit by the telekinesis. That was a little interesting. And if he had got caught mid-leap, he might have actually died there. So that was a really interesting interaction.
Yeah, I was just about to say, that's a very weird interaction. I didn't realize that's how it worked. Because I know, like Timbersaw, remember back before the nerf with the Timbersaw stuns, what happened was, as soon as you got off your Timber Chain, and actually Earth Spirit works the same way, if you get into the ball form before you roll, whether you get stunned afterwards or not, your ball or your chain will go in the previous Timbersaw as well as the current Earth Spirit. But Leap, you're actually supposed to be able to get canceled mid-air. Like, I've seen interactions where, like, the Priestess gets stunned right in the middle, and then she just gets cut off in her tracks by the telekinesis. But in that case, she almost pretty much completed her leap, and it almost looked like the cast animation on the telekinesis was a little bit delayed. But yeah, that was really funny, because that Rubick was nowhere near the Priestess at the end of that leap.
Yeah, that was, and much to the dismay of the Rubick, because they may have had a chance to actually be able to, unfortunately, again, two really defensive supports like that, not a whole lot of damage they can put down. But there was a chance they could have possibly been able to finish off the Mirana if she had actually got caught out, you know, mid-leap like that and sent back. But unfortunately, it looks like this aggression just going to continue, and the arrow, Park unable to hit the disruption in time. It's just a very, very easy combo for 5 and Q to be able to throw out with the double slow. Very, very hard to be able to dodge that arrow. And again, The aggressive tri-lane really doing a lot of work here as J-God's going to try and do a little bit of pulling here, but it's honestly too little too late at this point in time. Now Cynical going to round out the back, and they're just going to just sandwich on top of Hot right now. J-God going to be the first to fall, but we'll see if Karn is able to make it out. Rubick just trying to delay as much as possible. The nukes are going to go down. He does fall eventually. Teleport in. Gosh. Oh, Clockwork. What are you doing, buddy? Arrow to the face, and he instantly goes down. Karn finally gets the TP scroll, and he will be able to get out just in time before the rest of 5&Q can hunt him down. But already 6.5 minutes in, and 5&Q are grouping up quite a bit and to very, very effectively shut down the Luna and possibly take down a tier 1 very, very early on as well.
And looks like they're not done. Yep. Sagan's going in alone, and he's going to secure the kill because he has the phase boots and he has that extra movement speed. There goes the Shadow Demon, and of course the Fade Bolt kicking in afterwards to no avail, of course, in terms of saving the Shadow Demon. And yeah, just as you said, man, the tier 1 tower going down. But honestly, the lack of Korean experience, I think, demonstrated itself in the finest form right there. When you're against a tri-lane, and one of your heroes has died, so you create a 3v2 scenario, the last thing you want to do, and Cap, I mean the absolute last thing you want to do, is take away your own creep wave that'll tank for you.
Yep.
If you don't have a creep wave and the only thing you're relying on in tower is tower, this is not League of Legends, man. The tower will not always hit the heroes on the nearest proximity, and it just doesn't work in a way that if you understand how the aggro works, you can bypass it very, very easily. So this aggressive tri-lane that's already been dominating you, you are going to lose a hero and say to them that, oh, you know what? We just lost a hero to you. I'm gonna give you my creeps. Attack. Take them away from the lane so you can dive us even easily.
Yep.
Even easier.
Yeah, and you combine and that with the Darkseer going missing in mid as well. Now, he just happened to pick up the perfect rune for rotating to top, but still, he was missing for that small amount of time as well.
Of course.
Free dive.
You know, that's just how it goes. That's what happens when you're snowballing. You just snowball even harder. And, and of course, the Clockwork deciding to say, hey, my team is just getting wiped. Let me try it and go, and boom, arrow to the face. Like, there was a Slark sitting on right on top of the TP with three heroes to the right, maybe like 2 meters away, and he still completed this TP. I'm a little bit surprised on that movement. I'm not too sure what to say, because now what they're doing is, at 8 minutes into the game, they're doing something called team jungling, and team jungling most of the time is not in a good form.
No, it really isn't. Remix is sitting up here, and even with the team jungling, Karn barely able to get out of that escape, dodges the arrow nicely, but still, when your team jungling like that and you still aren't like responding to the aggressive tri-lane in any way, like you have this offlane Clockwork who was able to pick up level 6, he's not attempting to hide himself whatsoever. He just put himself in clear vision of the creeps and is now going to sit here and wait for this hook. And I really question, even if they do get the jump, whether or not they're actually going to make a favorable trade at this point in time. They're just such a high level, 5&Q, this aggressive tri-lane. Those very, very high-level nukes, like Soul Assumption, is going to blow somebody up. One of those supports is pretty much dead from a level 3 Soul Assumption by itself. You combine, like, the nukes of Crystal Main, who has a maxed-out Crystal Nova. Karn going to get gone on here. Telekinesis is going to interrupt the arrow, but it's still going to go down eventually. Starstorm actually gets thrown, and that's going to be enough. So Luna goes down, and Clockwork still not in a position to be able to interrupt this. Looking for the hook. Finally lands it on two of the supports. And now going to go on Artageek, trying to turn this, and will pick up one of the supports, but he may just trade his life for it. Actually, support coming in. Cynical not actually going uphill, and it looks like FX doing a little bit of turning here in the slow. He's going to go down, unfortunately, because of the Templar Assassin. And so they do finally get themselves, eventually, they get themselves a trade that is in their favor, but it takes all five heroes to go top in order to do so.
Yeah, and you know what? I'm so glad you didn't let me talk, because as soon as that whole engagement was going on, even after the arrow, I thought that 5&Q was going to wipe them. And to my surprise, it turned out the other way, that they actually did lose their hero. So instead of a 9-0 advantage, the scoreboard now becomes 9-2. But really, man, just a couple more plays, a couple more movements, and a little bit more awareness. I really do think, yeah, just as you said, with the level advantage that 5&Q had and better mana management, they would have been able to secure some really, really critical kills, which would have allowed them to just return the fire on the Templar Assassin who was rotating in. Seriously, I think with all the stuns they had and better mana management, they would have been able to secure the immediate burst from the Shadow Demon, who was a sitting duck as soon as he came out of the disruption. That's one of the reasons why, like, it's just not good in the double defensive support lane. Like, you force yourself into that kind of situation, next thing you know, you're dead, because 2.5 seconds later, all you've done is set up for the enemy team. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's a rough situation all around. Now the Slark's rotating to top lane with an ultimate ult first item, which leads me to believe that this is one of those infamous Scotty Slark builds, which in terms of theory and on paper, it's like, it's what people say, like, quote unquote, is the most efficient item. I've never really bought it personally, because Slark actually doesn't need to have a frost attack to be useful or chase down for kills. Mm-hmm. But speaking of which, you know, he's going on Karn right now, and he does miss that, and Karn does TP, so looks like Karn has enough awareness to know.
Yep, just able to get out. Unfortunately, he just still is not level 6. He has no, like, obviously, Slark doesn't really care about the Eclipse, but still, like, not having that, like, defensive ulti to be able to throw down, that's really the biggest thing, I feel, for level 1. Level 1 Luna ult is just, it makes it really questionable whether or not you actually want to go for that gank. You really have to throw numbers down.
Absolutely.
And 12 minutes in, not having that ultimate, it's just Luna's going to have a very, very hard time farming in any sort of lane. You know, 5-and-Q, they're just going to group up. They're just going to 5-man, so they, because they do have that very, very early mech coming out from the Darkseer. And if Haunt ever try and like split up at all and try to utilize this 5-man by doing a little bit of split pushing or trying to utilize their jungle effectively, you know Slark's going to be looking for those kills. He's going to be looking for those pickoffs. Jumping in, Shadow Demon, maybe in a bit of trouble. Here's the disruption goes down. Arrow lands on J-God as well. And now Depo trying to get away, just barely trying to get that meld out. Unfortunately, just not going to be enough. And now the supports are in trouble. QO, he's going to go for more. Dive in tier 3 towers like no problem with the Ion Shell. Picks off 2 of the supports and 4 go down for Don't Die. And 13 to do, 12 and a half minutes in. It's looking like a very, very short series, Clairvoyance.
Cap, I remember the timing that I took down last game. It was at 18 minutes approximately that 5-and-Q decided to push the Radiant Tier 2 and ended up actually not pushing the Tier 2, but pushing the enemy at the Tier 2 and completing an ace on the opposition, creating a 5-kill scenario and a rampage team-wise. Mm-hmm. This time, at 13 minutes, 5 minutes earlier, they managed to actually secure 4 kills, and they've done it by going inside the enemy base this time, past the Tier 3. This is progression. And this is a positive progression for 5-and-Q, but a negative progression for our friends at Hot. All of a sudden, they're looking a little bit cold on their side.
You were just waiting for that one. You were waiting eventually to throw
actually,
that one, weren't
I'm
you?
I'm not even going
to
lie. I wasn't preparing for that. I'm just like, what am I going to say that's clever here? And, you know, hot and cold, why not, you know?
What do you think about the Yule Scepter picked up by Cynical?
Yule Scepter. Yeah. Oh, yes, it's in his stash.
Yeah.
To be frank, I think at this point he can kind of pick up anything.
That's true. That's true.
But, you know, the mana management is what I think he's aiming for. But really, if he's a team player, he would have gone for the mana boots. That's just what the player does.
Yeah, I was like, heals? All right. Fair enough.
I don't really see a point in the 2.5 second setup. I mean, so far, it looks like the Shadow Demon is giving it to them, so.
Oh man, free heal scepter. What do you know? QO aggressively pushing past the tier 2 tower to clear through the creep wave and allowing his allies to beat on the tier 2 real quickly. Just, not a whole lot of options here for Don't Die. Another arrow being thrown out. Slark just going for it. He doesn't matter. He's just going to try and get close as possible. And if he's in any real trouble, he'll just pop his ultimate. Karn getting pushed back. And now Remix locking himself in with the Slark. And there goes that ultimate. And Slark is just fine. Now going to go for more as he starts going into the tier 3 once again. And now Depo in some serious trouble. The refraction. Double refraction comes out. And it gets melted both times by all of that damage over time coming out from the Ion Shell, the Dark Pack. It's just too much. Like, Templar Assassin was just not the pick you were really wanting to pick up here. It's just, there's just no way Templar Assassin could be effective. Really, you needed a hero that was going to be aggressive, that was going to be able to clear room for the Luna. And unfortunately, Templar Assassin just wasn't that hero.
Yeah, against the Darkseer seems like it was a... It seemed like it was more of a calculated response to Hot. So I can see where Hot is coming from. Unfortunately, I think in this game, to be specific, because of just by judging how bottom lane lost really quickly because of that first blood, and the top lane was a complete disaster for Hot. I'm not too sure if there was any hero at mid that could have actually salvaged it. Maybe one that like completely guarantees a mid lane victory or something like that. But there's not too many aside from what's been banned. So as I say that, engagement at the mid lane again.
Yep, Ruby goes down and Depo takes the arrow that was supposed to be for J-God. Now Park is going to get gone on. Refraction instantly melted once again. Slark in a little bit of trouble. Pops his ultimate and he's right back up to half health. No problem. Karn going to try and turn this around a little bit and does get the kill. Cynical, unable to keep going, and now he's going to have to back out another arrow. Jagon takes it this time. Unfortunately, 5NQ diving into tier 4s. Not really on their plan just now, so they're going to go ahead and back off. They lost this Lark. They gave a third kill to Hot. That's not what you want to see. You want this flawless victory. So they're going to back up. Oh, as I say that, Anarchy goes ahead and picks off the Luna. Now going to go for Jagon as well. Disruption. 2.5 seconds, and here comes the Visage Familiars resummon and looking for that kill. But they are actually having to back out. Anarchy may get caught out here. Remix just trying to get in range of that battery assault and then turns around. Tries to go on Sagan, but he has a leap. He's going to be able to get away. Still no hook shot up for him. Another 20 seconds. FX trying to get away. 5NQ just feels like they're just slowly but surely outmaneuvering Hot. Now looking for that turnaround. Arrow gets thrown, but that one's going to completely whiff. And 5NQ are really pushing their luck here with support sitting around 150 health. Visage, it doesn't matter. They're just going to keep on going as Cynical takes his time pushing in top.
Yeah, well, can you blame them, man? They really are just so far ahead at this point that they're just wandering inside. It's like enemy base is pretty much their territory, as we can see. Just as you said, 150 HP supports lying around in the enemy jungle. That's not what you see every day in a competitive match, but neither is about, like, what? This is, we're looking at about
20 minutes,
17. Yeah, 17 minutes Scotty, I would say, because he just needs the point booster and the Orb of Venom. He's purchasing him right now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's cheaper now. So there it is, 17 minutes Scotty. Not something that you see every day. For one, Scotty doesn't get bought up that often, but for another, you don't see it that often, that early often. So yeah, that's a lot of farm coming out of the Slark this time. A change of pace from the last game, Slark, but also in a different lane this time, and with a better setting, of course, and a better matchup. So yeah, this is the effectiveness of Slark, how he can just dive into towers and become extremely hard to punish, even though he's dishing out, 300 damage with 75 mana pounds and keeping the targets there and pretty much being invulnerable for, like, every 5 seconds. He just has invulnerability frames when it comes to stuns because Dark Pact goes for, like, a small duration and it also has a delay. So, yeah, with interesting mechanics and a hero that's certainly incredibly potent when it comes to being played at the highest level. I could
have hit Roshan. And now, if they needed anything more after, over... So 18, 19,000 gold lead. Like, oh, they needed any more, they're going to go ahead and pick up Roshan too.
Holy moly, you're right. They got a 20k gold lead in under 20 minutes.
Yeah.
They've literally been farming 1,000 gold extra over the enemy. Like, you have to be playing like
this. Oh, Remix looking to make the steal that QO did last time. Unfortunately, Slark was able to snag it. And this looks like a really bad team fight now. Hot just going to try and get themselves out of here. That was their one. Maybe small hope is to make some sort of big play and steal the Aegis. Unfortunately, Clockwork unable to secure it. Now they're just going to hide out in their base. And what a vacuum! Cynical brings Jagon out of his own base. Now on the other side, they quickly clear up another one. Fortunately, hey, one good thing about this game, Clairvoyance, when you're this far behind, the enemy's pushing into your base at 19 minutes. Very low death timers. So maybe Hot just going to be able to throw enemy hero wave after wave of heroes, and eventually they'll come out on top. I don't know, but this tier 3 not looking long for this world. Glyph is going to give it a couple of minutes here, but Park unable to disrupt in time, and now he's going to go down. Auto attacks. Karn going to try and turn around with his Eclipse. Unfortunately, it's just not enough. And 5NQ pick up 3 little easy hero kills. Shadow Demon buyback. Something tells me it's not going to be all that effective. There goes the Yule's leap, and doesn't even go down before he casts. Well, he got Purge off at least. And QO may go down here. Of course, he does have the Aegis. Again, throwing enemy heroes. Hot just trying to win with numbers at this point in time, unfortunately. Calling the GG before the 20-minute mark. And 5NQ going to end this in style. A 30-3 kill score.
Right on 20 minutes, man. Right on 20 minutes. Don't forget that. 30 to 20 to 3. Right on.
Beautiful.
Look at those numbers. They're beautiful. Absolutely, man. What can I say, though? One-sided series. Nothing to really go shy about that. 5NQ just straight up outplaying the opponents. First game, you know, they used their own selection of heroes and maneuvered around with it. Did a lot of snowballing and, of course, a couple what I would like to call a little bit of overextending here and there. And in game two, absolutely no hesitation on pressing the trigger, no hesitation on the foot on the pedal, just rushing full throttle, full speed throughout the entirety of the way with the first blood, as well as successfully outmaneuvering the opposition in the tri lanes, allowing the snowball scenarios to kick in. And look at their heroes, man. This is the result. 20 minutes, over 20k gold advantage, over 20k EXP advantage cap. You have to be playing like for you to actually have that in a normal game, you have to be playing like 5v3 at the start or something. And the two extras that on your team cannot be missing creeps, literally, to have that advantage. That goes to show how much killing that 5NQ has been doing, if it's not just by the numbers.
Yeah, amazing. Amazing. Two different heroes with no deaths whatsoever, both Mirana and Darkseer. Not having a problem. Well, guys, that's going to be it for this series 5NQ. Taking it very convincingly, they're going to move on to the semifinals. Now, this is double elimination, so you haven't seen the last of Don't Die / Hot. We will see them again in the lower bracket because this is double elimination. But next, coming up, we've got Eyes of Tiger Hammer versus Team Angry Birds. That's going to be next on the list. And, you know, Clairvoyance, they only gave 2 hours between best of threes, and with a 45-minute delay for game one, I was like, oh, this series is going to run real, real late. Somehow, some way, 2 hours for a best of three series, actually an hour and 15 minutes, actually turns out to be just perfect. So we should be able to immediately get into that next series. Clairvoyance, man, are you taking off?
I do believe I am. All but right. Cap, let me just touch upon your point right there, man. We Koreans, we always got the stuff calculated on the dot, all right? So let me tell you that 45-minute delay, on behalf of my brethren in the motherland, I'd like to say that this was calculated, well-planned, and flawlessly executed. So with that, I would like to bid you adieu. But first, before I go, I'd like to actually make a plug-in. Because, Cap, absolutely. 2014 is a big year for Clairvoyance. It's a big year for me, and it's a big year for Dota, of course. It's always going to be a big year for Dota, no matter what the year is. But I made a Twitter, man. And it's got a really nice catchy name. Check it. It's called Twitter.com / CV has arrived. How do you like that?
So you could say it's @ CV has arrived?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's right. That's the Twitter talk. Man.
That's what we call in the biz Twitter
talk. That's true. Yeah. All right. Thanks. I'm just learning, baby steps one at a time.
I understand.
But @ CV has arrived. You know, it has the perfect ring. And for those of you who's been in the gaming business for a while, you know, from the Brood War days, you understand when you make that carrier in Brood War, it says carrier has arrived. And all of a sudden, you know, you're going to get carried. But this time, something better. CV has arrived.
Something better.
How do you feel about that, Cap?
Oh, I love it. I love it. Honestly, it answers the question that I've been asking myself all throughout 2013. I was like, where's CV on Twitter? Like, where is he? And now I know. 2014. CV has arrived. He's here, baby. He's here for
That's
me
how we
and
do
you.
In America, man. That's just how we do in America.
I love it. I love having you on, man. We need to do this more often.
What can I say? Thanks for letting me be here. Of course, I know I'm calling it a little bit early, but I do want to get my beauty sleep for the night because long weekend coming up ahead of me. And best of wishes to you. I do believe I'll be contacting you soon about a couple other things here and there. But once again, thanks for having me, man. I'm always looking for the opportunities to be here.
Awesome. Thanks so much for joining me, man. As for you guys at home, short little music break and everything else, and we will be moving on to the second series of the day, Eyes of Tiger Hammer versus Team Angry Birds.